last lecture, my preacher Ginot, who will tell us more about differential studies.
Differential studies.
Thank you. So let me start by a comment about what was not clear yesterday. Stacks are very good to create nice quotients, but they don't create magically nice pullbacks or nice intersections. For instance, the pullback of differential stacks, that's not a differential stack. So it could be more like a topological stack. It was kind of misleading because I didn't state it explicitly yesterday. So if you want to have both nice quotients and nice pullback, then better go to the world of derived stacks and this kind of thing, which is even more complicated. If you want, you can do it. Okay, so let me start by giving some examples. Examples are good. So first let's again look at the very stupid case of stacks, which is obtained by studying the point of a compacted group, or by a group actually. Q is a manifold, or N is a manifold. Then, if you remember the Ginot principle, we know what it is saying. That's what we want to say. It's the same thing as the map is X. Of differential stacks from M to this stack. Okay, and what is this stack? Remember, it's by definition as objects, it's the stack. Objects. So the objects here are just principal G bundle over M.
The
another magic by pulling back this button. So, yeah, really close. The difference here is that, well, first, we've been forgetting about the impact of differential geometry because we're looking at critical spaces. And also, we're not looking to just one map, but to homotopy classes of things. So, even if we're looking for a smooth manifold, then there will be like many smooth homotopy functions. Well, smooth would not really make sense because the guy is not a manifold. So anyway, these two statements are related, and that's what I'm going to tell later. I think essentially that this stack and this space are homotopy to each other. And in some sense, this statement relies on this thing, but in the context of differential geometry, and really you can get rid of the notion of a map of stacks, get rid of the homotopy classes here. Just identify them. Always have a canonical isomorphism with itself, which is given by z equals to minus z.
remember the principle of time is that if we have like some isomorphism, we should not forget it. So that's why I'm dividing like SL2 and not DSL2.
So another question looking at, but when you do this question, you do actually
exactly get every isomorphism classes of elliptic curves together with some higher isomorphisms. So generally at almost every point we have only a group of automorphism which is C over 2Z, which is given by Z plus Z, but you will have some elliptic curve where you have like a bigger root of set isomorphisms. Would be 0 over 4 or 0 over 6.
Let me say it.
Okay, so that was exactly it. You can prove that that's a good exercise. I don't want to do it because it would be too long, but you can prove that actually it's exactly the same thing as if you were defining another stack that would be families, but over any. So, if you leave, then this thing is just, voilà. The now, principal SL2Z bundle over you. Together with an SL2Z equivalent map, which you can prove that this stack is actually isomorphic as a stack to another stack which will be, whose object will not be a set to the principal bundle over U, but families over U whose fibers are exactly Riemann surfaces. Riemann surfaces of elliptic curves, together with isomorphism of elliptic curves. And well, that's a good exercise to prove that these two things are equivalent. But that's the way you get that this stack is actually the stacks, the good stack, well, the good moduli stack of elliptic curves. Okay, so now I want to explain what I was saying about BG and say a little bit, a few things about algebraic topology of stacks.
Would your second definition work? I mean, your first definition required explicitly understanding elliptic curves, but your second definition said that L attaches to M, the families of elliptic curves over M. So that makes sense for any genus?
Yeah, you can define something for any genus too, yeah. Yeah, the second term, yeah, exactly. That's the way you, that's the usual way where you define the stack of the moduli stack of genus G surfaces. That's usually the way you use. It's just short periods before it occurs. Okay, so let me go through a little bit of algebraic topology of stacks. So, for that I have to tell you what I mean by the homotopy type of stack, because if not, we have to, some trouble to make sense, so let me do it this way. Let me make the following proposition. So, X is the definition of stacks. Then the proposition is that there exists a topological space. satisfying. So let me write it here. So I should say something here about topological stacks. So I've been studying what differential stack, but you can replace the category differential by topological, the category of topological space, or nice topological spaces like set volume complexes. And you can make this, the same definitions, and you will add, we get what are topological stacks. And again, topological spaces will embed in topological stacks. And of course, any differential stacks has an underlying topological stack, like the same way as any remanifold has an underlying topological structure. So you can define the map from topological space, that's what I mean, into the stack. Such that, which is universal, which is a universal weak on the equivalence, meaning the definition of an atlas when we are defining a differential stack. Except that we don't ask for when we do come back against relative summation, we ask for getting weak homotopy equivalences. And we do that on spaces. The definition. So once you have that, that means that this space is defined up to unique homotopy equivalences. Defined uniquely up to homotopy equivalences. So say, of the space. And once you have that, well, you can define every algebraic topology functor for X because you just have to define it for the space. Yeah, the space, that's what you get. Construction which starts with a group and you construct some simplicial space, all of it. and you take geometric gradation. Or you can do the same thing for any Gaussian stack. You can define a classifying space. But instead of trying to use the full dimension, I'm just going to make the example of what's going on for the forms.
Thank you.
at zero. And here we have another map, which is going to be T3, which is well the other way around, take the identity and the identity, and here we take the target map, I think, or defining it this way. And I guess I don't know that you have that, and you know how to do it for every n. Always multiplication in the middle and source and target, which will fall zero and n. Okay, so we have this map, so we have this map from here to here. And that means that if we take the differential forms, we get. And then we get back on TI, which goes from the K form on Xn, minus 1, sorry, to the K form on Xn. Because it's going to use that direction when you take for Xn. So, let me write.
So let me define omega j for all k of
this translate x0 over x1
by saying that this thing is the sum for all I plus g equals k of omega I of xj.
So, you're just saying that a K form, that's a direct sum of forms where you take a I form together to leave the next tree. So, last year you have the K form of X0, and then just you have X8. And for this guy, you have two differential coming from this guy to the K plus 1 of this guy. So you can take the Durham forms on each of these guys. That's giving you something from omega I of x to omega I plus 1 of x. Or you can take each of these guys give you something, which is going to commit with the Durham differential because it's just come from a manifold. So you can take the sum of all these guys and probably have to do something plus that choice. So you have to see that it seems this DI is going to keep the omega p constant. That's what I keep. But it gives omega s q plus 1, so it's actually something in the domain of q plus 1. Okay, and so the claim is that could this be p? Okay, it means g is a differential, so 0 and g is equal to 0.
So is it correct, for instance, if I take x0 point x1 at a root, that you get the book module?
Yeah, that's what I'm going to say right now. That's the first example I'm going to say. Yeah, obviously that's the first example you have to take.
So
we have to make this thing, doesn't
So here you're not using the whole group point structure, right?
And that
you use the inverse of n to this definition.
No, you should degeneracy don't.
I don't use the degeneracy.
You use the degeneracy, yes.
There are sort of hidden in the picture, but this guy computes exactly the correct method of the type. That's where they are. It's always the same thing when you have a simplicial thing.
Yes.
To define it's a chain complex, you don't need to use the degeneracy. Actually, you can model by the space of degeneracy.
So this is
a small complex, and it's going to be the same.
Yes.
Yeah, so what I'm just, which I haven't been saying, is I'm just using the fact that this Xn is a simplicial manifold. And I'm using this simplicial structure to get something. Oh, okay, so what I wanted to say was the first proposition. I've been defining that for this specific choice of representation of my differential results, but the thing is that the forms the extra, which are already to do with alternate signs. So if you see that, then that's very easy to see that actually all these terms for the n cube or cube bigger than 1, they all cancel out each other. I just want to contribute to promote so you get that. That is, you get that now. It's the usual thing. To the usual forms on n, the manifold n. Which is lucky because, I mean, we were saying that manifolds, seen as stack, were the same thing as manifolds, so if the invariant was different, that would be annoying. And of course, the classifying space for M seen as a manifold is M itself. That's the case. A more interesting example is the case on property. So, when this is the same. Well, in the case of point over G, then what you get is that's the contrary. So, forms on x0, that's the thing, because this is a point. You can get that omega k of G is the sum of, I'm sorry, G of omega t. Of g and the power q, and take it in this case, x q is always equal to g by q in this case. And what we are computing? Well, the homology. That is just the homology. The homology of EG, the usual classifying space, the group, which is the same thing as the energy of the coefficients in R, the homology of the group. And by that I mean, I remember that this guy is a Lego, keep remembering the structure, but I don't see that the discrete group. Yeah, which is the same thing as the equivalent homology of the point. And that's actually a general picture. Okay, so in general, x is computing the g equivalent domain of the coefficient in R. That's a general picture. And if you want to construct the classifying space of the stack in terms of the guide, well, it's just given by the geometric precision of the simply shown manifold X. That's a concrete way of computing it. Any questions for our first?
I mean, can you also put the algebra structure on?
So, yeah, there is an algebra structure on that.
In general, on the stack, on differential forms on the stack.
Yeah, on differential forms.
And then these
are. But that's not a commutative algebra structure.
But then the quasi isomorphism is a quasi isomorphism of differential gradients.
Yeah, of differential gradients. So in general, it's only a commutative up to multiple. It does an infinity algebra structure. And that's a quasi isomorphism of infinity algebra. So, and it's basically exactly what you really think it is. It's just you take forms on the omega, you take coefficient of omega k. And then we have to use the proper structure to mix up the xp and xq. You have to go from xp times xq to xp plus q. That's where you have to use, as you do in, if you want to construct the gap product of the cohomology, so using the Einem-Danzenberg and Alexander mini maps. And that's where you have to break the commutativity. So things are only commutative but the multiples. Yeah. So yeah, here it is. Okay, so I'll say that.
That's one of the annoying things, is that general stack doesn't have permanent space, but we can still do something.
Okay, so what I wanted to say, by the way.
I mean, you can define, by the way, identity, but there is a definition, there is a notion of vector bundles over stacks. There are several ways of defining that, but you can say that this is going to be just an x. Usually a vector model, that means a map of two manifolds.
Think that this thing is a tangent bundle of the
except that my super AP, except that, well, that's not the vector tandem in general. That's the annoying.
Annoying part.
In general. Divided by the trigger action of the algebra seen as a It has a group structure which is just given by addition. And so this thing is really very different. And so why it was different? Well, obviously, this thing is not a vector. It's not a vector space. It's just a G over something. That's a stack. It's definitely not. Which is not manifold. That's obviously not the image of if. And so if the fibers have to be vector, so more to Rn, that would be if. So in fact, what is this thing? Well, that's one of the examples of a pretty easy example of a curve. In fact, these things, this construction, in fact.
Fiber form a Chevalier number complex of the ordinals.
So let me say that in general, this thing's space to be a vector bundle, but that doesn't mean that it was not interesting. In general, they are just a vector question. In general, one has to consider that you have to use a logical algebra, not a vector bundle or a stack, but what's called a function complex. Function on this thing, then you recover the Chevalier. let me just say then a few words on what are geodes in computer science.
How much time is left?
5 minutes, 5 to 6 minutes.
So we'd say something, well, we'd give a definition of something basic. So I want to come back to So let me just speak about GGI. So, well, the principle of a GGI is something slightly similar to a principal bundle, except that a principal bundle over manifold M. Well, that means the manifold P where you have the projection, which is locally trivial, and the fibers are the morphic G. So locally. You have something like that. P is M times G over M. And GX on the multiplications. So GGI is going to be something similar, but now you are working over stacks. So instead of looking that the fiber is G, you're going to look that the fiber is point over G, it's the stack. So GGI. You're already working with stacks, and it makes sense to make this definition for stacks too. But your stacks can be just a manifold. That's something wrong. I'm writing this thing so that you have a picture of what it should be. Not really like a mathematical definition. It's the principle. So that means that locally, P to X, which locally looks like So if you look at that, that means that essentially your space of objects in X is unchanged, because this guy doesn't do anything on the space of objects. But you have much more arrows. Well, you have G many times in arrows. So if you try to think to see what's going on here, I don't have time to write it, but you will see that if you try to mean what means this thing in terms of local data. In terms of local data, that means that basically it's a G principal bundle. You have to replace M by a proper, by trivialization, and your local trivialization won't be the same in two different programs. So you will get a cycle map from U I J to G. Here, the automorphism of the trivialization are not given by maps into G, but they are related to these things. So the automorphism of point over G as a stack, that's just the automorphism of G as a group. So you will get two co-cycles with value in automorphism of G. And then this thing that will be a groupoid, so like a stack, so that means that you have local multiplications. And the local multiplications are going to give you three co-cycles conditions with value in G. So let me say it otherwise. Okay, so since I don't have time, I just need to give a precise definition of something slightly similar to the general figures. So this definition is really the same thing as what is called non-Abelian two-cycles with images. And you can make the definition very precise, and you can write it as saying that these things, these data, are the same thing as a is something else. That's the proposition. What is called G extensions. Simple G extensions. And the format is. That's an exact sequence. An exact sequence, that's right. Exact sequence. Group weights are like this. So where this thing is a bundle of group. What you are looking at is when you do this thing,
you have to remember that a stack is like a quotient. So this thing looks like you are looking to a group whose quotient is actually a group, but it's a trivial group in this case, is the point, but which has like a lot of automorphisms which are themselves a group. So there's a general picture of group stacks, group object in stacks, which can be represented by leaf group weights, something this way. That means the quotient of a group by another group, but in a sense that you have this quotient, but this quotient has a lot of higher automorphisms like in the stacks, so you want to remember the two things. And to do that concretely, you have to do exactly what I was doing for stacks, but in the higher level, the categorical level, which is called two stacks. If you do that, you have exactly a parallel definition of what are principal dependents in the same setting by the same thing. It's exactly the same thing. That's why I start.
Any questions?
But
yeah.
So you said that when G is not abelian, then this is not a group in stacks.
No.
But what kind of structure does it have?
So this is just a stack, but the thing is when you try to define what it means to be a GGR and to make precise this thing and the thing that you should have a group structure, then there's a true group which is associated with that. So the real true group that is around here to you. So you can remake this thing in a similar picture, but there we really need to use a true group, not like a stupid true group which was looking like that.
Mm-hmm.
What's it? Then the true group is just this one. So you have a map of G, the automorphism of G, which is just the map given by the adjoint action. And well, that's the true group, and that's the map, which is I. And in fact, if you take this statement, and that you get rid of central, then you get exactly, you cannot really make sense of that. This thing, you just replace it by the true group G plus the automorphism of G. So this thing is really a group. So this thing gives rise to a group stack, which you can think as being in one side the quotient of this thing, so we get the author automorphism as the underlying base space, of course modular space, and it has automorphism which are given by the essentially the center of G. So of course when and you always have a canonical map going this way. Just some guy in the center, and you realize that the adjoint action person in the center is trivial. So the statement, if you call the statement and the one before, just saying that the central integer is a integer whose two group structure reduces to the one given by the center. It's like just a reduction property if you do it this way. So yeah. So really you have the true group playing a role, and the true group playing a role just is when you look at this gap. And if you want things with respect to orientation, then just automorphism and freedom of orientation.
Any other questions? Okay, if not, let's thank. So we meet in 30 minutes.